Good morning. Welcome to the Chaz Ford Baptist Church Space Station. You walk the halls, you'll know. It feels like it's in space around here. It's great to see you here in the house of the Lord. We're going to start singing this morning our hymn book, number 12, in our hymn book, number 12, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. We'll stand together, sing all four verses, number 12.
It's good to see each of you here. Brother Jack Santan, would you open our service in prayer this morning, sir? Amen. You may be seated. Again, we do welcome you to the service for the Lord this morning, this beautiful Lord's Day. It is a joy, blessing to see each of you here. If you're visiting with us, we're especially glad to have you with us this morning. You're our honored guests. We're delighted to have all of you here this morning. Let me mention some of the announcements in your bulletin. There'll be no choir practice this afternoon, so keep that in mind. And no choir practice. We will have our Sunday evening service, and it'll be our VBS kickoff. So we'll be having puppets tonight, special prayer for the staff. We're excited about Vacation Bible School. That'll be all this week, Monday through Friday, from 9 to 12. And if you have children that you haven't registered, if you could register them today, that would be a big help to us. There's also some sign-ups back there on the little desk in the foyer. And I know there's some for snacks and different things, staff snacks and other things. So if you could help us with those things, we'd be very appreciative of any help you could give us. Also tonight, right after church, there'll be a VBS meeting for all those who are helping. And this morning, right after the service, you'll see under miscellaneous items, there'll be a final meeting for the picnic committee. along with any other volunteers willing to help right after the morning service today. So keep that in mind. There will be the VBS lunch and closing program this Friday, right after VBS ends on Friday, so keep that in mind. And then Saturday will be our annual church picnic. We adjusted the time, the date of our picnic, because in the last couple of years we haven't been able to include our college and career kids who go back to school, and so we wanted them to be able to be a part. So we've adjusted the date a little bit, but it'll be this Saturday at the Hogues at 2 o'clock, and there is a plan in place if it rains. So if it rains, we will contact you and let you know what we're going to do. And I failed to mention Wednesday night, of course, we'll have our regular prayer meeting and as well as our youth ministry. So keep those things in mind. There is an insert about the church picnic, and it'll give you all the details on that. And just noticing this pie eating contest there. How about that? Would anybody really challenge me to a pie eating contest? I mean, come on now. But I'm on a diet, so I don't know what I'm going to do about this. I'm going to have to pray about this, I guess. But, all right, you have your August calendar in your bulletin as well. New nursery schedules are available for you. And also, we want to be an encouragement to Hope Martin. She's been struggling as of late, and so we have some cards for you to sign in the foyer. And we want to get those cards to her and be an encouragement to her in a special way. We had a wonderful trip to Honduras. We're glad to be back. We're going to report on that trip August the 2nd. You'll see that under upcoming events. We have lots of pictures, but we'll try to narrow them down. And we took some videos as well. We'll be giving testimonies and singing, and it'll be a special time. So I hope you'll plan to be with us for that special presentation. Our hearts were touched and blessed, and we have a lot to share with you that we're excited to share with you. But I want to tell you, it was an incredible trip, and praise the Lord for the good work He did in our hearts during that missions trip. Good to see you this morning. Again, we welcome you to the service. Brother Steve will lead us in our offertory hymn.
Thank you, Pastor. 458 for our offertory hymn this morning, 458. We remain seated. We'll sing the first and the third, and Now I Belong to Jesus. 458. Thank you. Before Pastor comes to preach, his wife will join him for a song.
Take your Bibles this morning to the book of 2 Peter. Chapter 1. Now, folks, we're living in dangerous days. Dangerous days of many devious disciples and damnable doctrines. And they're all around us. I'll give you one example. Here's a headline I read this week. Rick Warren has been confirmed as a speaker at Pope Francis's papal mass in Philadelphia on September 27th. He's the one who is the author of The Purpose-Driven Life that we warned you about many years ago. Should have been called The Purpose-Driven Heresy. But this is just an example of what's going on in our day. Now, I want to tell you about the devil. He is a peddler of counterfeits. And that's why we're going to go straight from 1 Peter right into 2 Peter. Because in 2 Peter, Peter is showing us and teaching us about authentic Christianity. What's it look like? I mean the real thing, genuine Christianity. And we're going to work our way through the course of the day. It'll be this, take us this morning and tonight. But we're going to work our way down to verse 10. I want you to look at it with me. It says, "Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure." Mark that word, sure. "For if you do these things, ye shall never fall." Let's pray. Father, thank you for the wonderful word of God. Thank you that we can gather around it, study it, glean from it, grow thereby. Thank you that it brings forth fruit in our lives. It never returns void. I pray you would use it to stir us. I pray you'd use it to challenge us, to draw us closer and make us more like Jesus Christ. Work in our hearts. Work in each family and home. Strengthen each one. Meet each need, Lord. Be that a need of salvation. Be it a need for surrender and service and sanctification. Whatever the need, Father, we ask for your help, for your grace, for your mercy, for your blessing. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Verse 10 again says, "Give diligence." And notice he's talking to the brethren. "Give diligence to make your calling and election sure." In other words, as Christians, there are some things that we should be absolutely sure about. I mean, there are some things we should be settled about and established and steadfast and sure about. We're not supposed to be doubting Christians, but shouting Christians, right? We're not supposed to be a question mark. We're supposed to be an exclamation point. We're not supposed to be hope-so Christians, but know-so Christians. And that's what Peter's going to teach us about. I mean authentic Christianity that you can know for sure, know that you know. Let's begin in verse 1. "Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and of our Savior, Jesus Christ." Now notice, by the way, Peter started out as Simon. You know what Simon means? Unstable. Now he's Peter. You know what Peter means? Rock. Boy, he is a beautiful illustration in the Scripture of progressive sanctification. One who started out very unstable, impetuous, immature, hot-tempered. Now he is rock solid. And he is writing to us, admonishing us. And notice he's writing to them that have obtained like precious faith. By the way, how do you get it? Well, he tells us right in the first verse. He says, "Through the righteousness of God and of our Savior Jesus Christ, you are made right with God and righteous before God through Jesus Christ our Savior." And he makes it very clear in the first verse. But I love this term, precious faith. Notice that. "To them that have attained like precious faith." Now, our faith is precious because it was not obtained by corruptible things, such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without spot and without blemish. It's a precious faith because it was purchased with the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, one of the astronauts, we're talking about space, we have a space theme. One of the astronauts who first walked on the moon and had returned was being interviewed, and the reporter asked him, "What did you think about when you were up there and you were walking around on the moon?" He said, "I want to tell you what I thought about." He said, "I thought about the fact that that spaceship that was going to take us back to Earth was made by the lowest bidder." What is that? I didn't make that up. Seriously. I'm thankful that our salvation was not purchased by the lowest bidder. I want to tell you, it was purchased by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And that makes our faith a precious faith. And not only will that faith take us to the moon, it'll take us all the way to heaven, all the way to eternal glory. So if you're saved this morning, you have this same like precious faith as Peter had. And I want you to see three things about it. We'll only see the first this morning. But I want us to see three things that will enable us to be able to say, you know what? I know. I'm sure. Three things. Number one, faith that knows. K-N-O-W-S. Faith that knows. Notice verse 2. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Knowledge. Through the knowledge. Faith that knows. Interesting. In this first chapter alone, this word knowledge, or a derivative from it, of it, is used 9 times. Now it's used 16 times in this little short epistle. But the point is, over and over and over again, Peter is talking about a faith that knows, a faith that is sure. And by the way, if you're going to have assurance, you have to have a faith that knows, a faith that knows. If you want peace to be multiplied in your heart, well, what does he say? You've got to have the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. And the more you know him, the more grace and the more peace will be multiplied in your heart and in your life. Assurance doesn't come from feelings. It doesn't come from feelings. Your feelings will be up one day and it'll be down the next. You know where assurance comes from? It comes from knowledge. I mean, you get it from something or someone that you know. And that's what Peter is saying right here. What's he saying? Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. It comes from knowing him personally, and then it is continually multiplied as you know him intimately in a close fellowship with him. In fact, look at that word knowledge there. Through the knowledge. Epignosis is the Greek term there. It means a close knowledge, a personal knowledge, an intimate knowledge. And it really means a super knowledge. That is, I mean, it comes from a personal relationship and an intimate, close fellowship with. And that's what the word knowledge means here. In other words, it's the opposite of a general knowledge. Or what we might call an intellectual knowledge. Just knowing some facts. I know that's a piano. And I know that's an organ over there. And I know that this is a pulpit right here. It's not talking about that kind of knowledge. It's talking about an experiential knowledge. That is, a knowledge derived from experience. From experiencing a personal relationship, a close fellowship, an intimate contact with. That's the type of knowledge he's talking about here. Do you want grace? Now listen, I'm talking about a Christian. Do you want grace and peace multiplied in your heart? I want to tell you very simply, draw close to Jesus Christ. Get to know him. I'm talking about know as it is used right here. Not know about him. I'm talking about knowing him through an intimate, close fellowship and relationship. Now you might say, I know that George Washington was the first president of the United States of America. Let me ask you something. Do you know him? You understand? There's a vast difference between a general, an intellectual knowledge, and an experiential knowledge. Knowledge that is derived because you have a personal relationship and an intimate, close fellowship with someone. And so he says, grace and peace be multiplied unto you. How? How is grace and peace multiplied in my life? Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Now listen, quite frankly, the reason we struggle so many times, the reason Christians struggle, the reason we doubt, the reason sometimes we get depressed and we even move into despair and despondency and we struggle and we stagger, the reason is identified right here. We don't have, though Christ is our Savior, we don't have that close, intimate, daily walk and fellowship with Him. And as a result, the grace of God and the peace of God is not being multiplied in our hearts and in our lives. And that's what Peter is alerting us to right here. The great desire and ambition of our heart should be as it was with Paul. He said this in Philippians 3 verse 10, that I may know Him. Now listen, he already knew Christ in the sense of salvation. He's talking about the same knowledge that Peter is talking about that comes not just from knowing Christ as Savior, but that comes from knowing Him through a close, intimate fellowship with Him. I thought about Abraham. Abraham in the Scripture is called the friend of God. Think about that. I thought about Enoch. Enoch, it is said, walked with God. I thought about David. The Scripture says he was a man after God's own heart. And I want to tell you why Paul had so much victory in his life. It was because the desire, the drive, the ambition in his heart and his life was that I may know Him in a greater way, in a deeper way, in a more intimate way. More about Jesus, the hymn writer has written, would I know more about Jesus. Love the verse in Daniel chapter 11, verse 32. It says, the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. Oh, that is, they'll have the power of God upon their lives and they'll do great and daring and bold acts and deeds for the Lord. That's what that verse is talking about. Now, folks, I want to ask you a sobering question. I want you to think about it this morning, okay? I want you to think about it. If you were to go to heaven today and meet Jesus Christ, would you be meeting a practical stranger? Or would you be meeting your very best friend? I want you to think about it. As a church, I want us to think about it. And I want to tell you, I'm thinking about it as well. Now, what does the knowledge of God, as Peter puts it here, and Jesus our Lord bring? Faith that knows. Faith that knows brings pardon. It brings pardon. Notice verse 2, the first word, grace. Grace and peace multiplied unto you. How is this grace multiplied unto you? Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. First of all, it's grace that saves us. We're saved by grace through faith. Grace is the unmerited favor and gift of God. God giving us what we do not deserve. God loved us. He gave us Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ gave us His life. We're saved by grace, how? Through faith. And notice what our verse says, through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Savior. Pardon comes through the knowledge of Jesus Christ, what He did for you on the cross of Calvary, His death, burial, shed blood, His glorious resurrection, when you personally put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, when you come to know Christ as Savior, your sins are forgiven, and it's all by the grace of God. But here's what I want you to understand. Peter's writing to Christians. Here's what I want you to understand. Grace does not end at salvation. Yes, there's saving grace. Hallelujah. Thank God for that. But grace does not end there for us as believers. There is God's daily grace. The songwriter has written, He giveth more grace. Absolutely. I want to tell you, there is sanctifying grace. The grace of God upon us that causes us to grow in our likeness to Jesus Christ daily. There is sustaining grace. That is the grace that carries us through all trouble and trial and difficulty in our life. There is serving grace. That is the grace of God upon us that enables us to serve the Lord. Oh, listen. Do you want that grace multiplied in your life? Well, you can have it. It comes, what does he say? Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Multiplied in your life. More about Jesus. The more you know of Him, oh, that I may know Him, the closer you draw to Him, oh, that intimate fellowship with Him, oh, the more grace is going to be multiplied in your life. Pardon, not only pardon, but peace. Notice verse 2 continues, grace and peace be multiplied unto you. How? Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. By the way, did you notice the order? Grace, then peace. You'll always find it that way in the Scripture. You'll never find it peace, then grace. You can never know peace apart from the amazing grace of God. You'll never know peace until you first experience the grace of God. And so it's always in this order, grace and peace. Now, how does it come? How does it come? Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. And I want you to understand something. So it is with grace, so it is with peace. Peace is not just when you get saved. It's not just talking about the peace that you have when you get saved. Yes, there is peace with God, but then this peace, as you walk with Jesus Christ, as you are in fellowship with Him, as you draw close to Him, this peace is multiplied in your life. And not only do you have peace with God, you have the peace of God. And that's why this is so, so important here. And I'm going to say again, the reason that many believers struggle and just don't have victory and they're in depression and despair is because there is a void in that fellowship with Jesus Christ. Oh, yes, they know Christ is Savior. Oh, but they're not walking with Jesus Christ in that close, intimate fellowship daily. And that is what multiplies peace in your heart. And in your life, the more you know Him, the closer you draw to Him, the more fellowship you have with Him, the more grace is multiplied in your heart. And the more that grace is multiplied in your heart, the more you will have the peace of God multiplied in your heart and in your life. We're talking about a faith that knows. A faith that knows. And through the knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord, we have grace, and therefore we have peace. But there's more. There's more. Not only that, we have power. Oh, this faith that knows, this faith that walks with Christ in daily, close, intimate fellowship, this faith that knows brings power. Power to our lives. Look at verse 3. According as His divine power. Do you want that? Boy, I do. His divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. How? through the knowledge of Him. There it is again. Folks, you realize when we're not walking with Christ, look what we are robbing ourselves of. Look at it. I'm telling you, the Word of God is putting its finger on our sore this morning. Really is. You know why we struggle? You know why we don't have the victory? I mean, He's putting His finger on it right here this morning. We can have divine power, but it's through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Oh, faith that is rooted in this kind of knowledge, is close, intimate, personal knowledge, is faith that brings the power of God to our life. In fact, look at it. I mean, folks, this is incredible. All things that pertain unto life. Now, what is not included there? You hear that? All things that pertain unto life and godliness. You have the divine power to meet all things that pertain unto life. How? Through the knowledge of Him, through Jesus Christ. And I'm telling you, the more you know Him, let me clarify, I'm not talking about salvation. The more you know Him, the more this divine power you're going to have upon your life. And that's why Paul went on to say in that same scripture in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection. Now let me ask you some questions this morning. Do you want the grace of God multiplied in your life? Don't raise your hand. Do you want the grace of God multiplied in your life in a greater way? Do you want the peace of God multiplied in your life in a greater way? Do you want the power of God upon your life in a greater way? Folks, He's telling us how right here. I'm telling you, and it's not hard to understand. You get on your knees before God, commit yourself this morning to drawing nigh to Him. That it is the ambition and desire of your heart, as it was with Paul, that I may know Him. I'm going to begin to walk with Him daily. I will be as Abraham. I will be the friend of God. My testimony will be as Enoch, who walked with God. My testimony will be as David, who was a man after God's own heart. That's how you do it. But I've got to point something out to you here, okay? You know what this verse says? You want all those things? They're all available to you. God's already laid them at your feet. They're at your disposal. I mean, notice verse 3. His divine power, what are the next two words? Hath given. They are available to you. They are available to me. Hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. In other words, everything you need to live the Christian life victoriously, you have at your disposal. Because they're all found in Christ, and Christ is in you. And Christ is in you. You say, why do I feel like I don't have them? I want to tell you why. Because we haven't possessed our possessions. They're ours. But we haven't possessed our possessions. Because we're kind of content with just being saved. And it's not the desire and the passion and the burning, yearning, longing of our hearts every day to walk in intimate fellowship with Christ and to know God in a greater way. And so while all these things God has given us, they're our possessions, they're there for our taking, we don't. How do they come? Well, through the knowledge of Him. Through the knowledge of Him. That's how. This is not hard to understand at all. You know, in the circus, it's interesting, in the circus when they're training a baby elephant, you know what they do? They put a steel cuff around his leg. A chain is attached to it, and that chain runs to some type of steel beam or something that's fixed that the elephant cannot move. So that baby elephant, he will, with his hind leg, he'll pull and he'll struggle and he can't move it. It's there, it's fixed. After a while, he stops trying. He stops pulling. The interesting thing is, when the elephant is grown and performing in the circus, you know what they do? All they do is just tie a little rope around his leg, run it over to a stake in the ground about yay deep. And do you know that elephant who could easily pull that stake right out of the ground doesn't? You know why? He doesn't think he can. He doesn't think he can. He doesn't even try. He doesn't think he can. He's just doing what in his mind he thinks he can do. Now, why am I pointing this out? Because this is what we do. This is what we do. Did you know the God I see determines the me that I see? And the me that I see determines the me that I'll be. Now, you get that? It's true. And that's why Peter's talking about knowledge. And that's why he's saying, I want to tell you folks something. You've got to really get to know God. And you've got to really get to know Jesus Christ. And I'm not talking about a surface knowledge. And I'm not just talking about knowing Him as Savior. I'm talking about knowing Him as Lord of your life. I mean walking with Him daily in that close, intimate fellowship. Because the God you see, the God you know, and the God you see is determining the person that you see and the person that you'll be. And that's why Peter is placing such an emphasis on knowing God and knowing Jesus Christ right here. He's given unto us, what does it say? All things that pertain unto life and godliness. It's all available to us. It says so right here. Oh, if we just know that and we begin to see God and see Christ in all of their glory and all the riches of their grace, it will change us. It'll change the me that I see and therefore the me that I'll be. Everything you need to have victory in Jesus is available to you. Everything you need to have a meaningful life in Christ, a fruitful life in Christ, everything you need to live the abundant Christian life is available to you through Jesus Christ. What am I saying? Draw nigh to Him. I mean, begin to seek Him as you have never sought Him before. Commit yourself afresh and anew to Him, and you'll begin to possess your possessions. Peter's teaching us about faith that knows. He says in verse 2, through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. He says in verse 3, through the knowledge of Him that hath called us to glory and virtue. What comes from that? Pardon, peace, power, and promises. Promises come from that. Look at verse 4. Whereby, all right, he's still talking about knowledge. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. You see, the Bible is crammed with these promises. I mean, they are there. But if you and I don't know them, and lay hold of them, what good are they going to do us? what good are they going to do us? In fact, notice the rest of verse 4. That by these promises, ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Now, don't misunderstand this verse. I want you to look at that word partakers there. It's an interesting term that means to be in fellowship with. In other words, you'll be in fellowship with the divine nature who is within you. You see, when you got saved, you receive the divine nature. You receive the Spirit of God. And Peter is teaching us how to be in fellowship, how to be in accord, how to be yielded to under the direction and wisdom of the divine nature within us. And why is this so important? Because it's our nature that determines our conduct. And that's why we have an old nature, and we have this new divine nature within us. And that's why it's so important that we be in fellowship with the divine nature, not the old nature, but we be in fellowship with the divine nature within us, because it's nature that determines our conduct. It's nature that shows us how to live. Let me give you some examples. Your behavior is determined by your nature. Eagles fly because that's their nature. Fish swim because that's their nature. And when you and I are in fellowship with the divine nature within us, it's going to be our nature to walk in holiness. I mean, to walk in victory in the Lord. Because it's our nature that determines our behavior. Not only is our behavior determined by nature, our appetite is determined by our nature. Now, you know, a pig loves slop. That's its nature. And you know, a dog will eat things that other things will not eat. You know why? That's its nature. In fact, I want you to turn over to chapter 2 and look at verse 22. Chapter 2 and verse 22. Your appetite is determined by your nature. Chapter 2, verse 22. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. Now, I'm not calling anybody a dog or a hog. Let me make that clear. I am pointing out that your behavior and your appetite both are controlled by your nature. And that's why Peter is saying, I want to tell you something. It is so important that you are in full accord with the divine nature within you, that you're in fellowship with the Spirit of God in you. Remember, he's talking about that close fellowship, that intimate walk with Christ, that intimate knowledge of the Lord God of heaven. Not only that, environment and association are determined by nature. Squirrels climb trees. That's their nature. Moles and groundhogs, they burrow under the ground. That's their nature. The fish swim in the water. That's their nature. And fish swim in schools. That's their nature. And birds fly in flocks. Why? That's their nature. And Christians love to be with other Christians in the house of God, because that's their nature. That's their nature. And Christians share the same divine nature, and they want to be together in God's house. So, your behavior, your appetite, your environment, your association, all is controlled by your nature. And that's why it's so important. In fact, look at verse 4 again. He says, whereby, he's talking about this knowledge, this intimate fellowship, this greater and deeper knowledge of Christ and of God as you walk with the Lord daily in the light of His Word, as you pray, as you study the Scripture, as you draw nigh to Him, whereby, by this knowledge, are given unto us exceeding great, and precious promises. Whoa, look at our possessions. We need to possess them. That by these divine promises, ye might be partakers of the divine nature. That is, you're just walking in communion and fellowship with the divine nature of God, with the Spirit of Christ in you, yielded to Him under His control and direction. He is leading you in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. He is ordering your steps. He is directing your path. That's what Peter is talking about right here. And when that happens, notice what he says is going to happen. You are going to live above this world. You're going to have victory above this world. And that's why this is so important. Notice what he says. Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Putting his finger on it. Why are so many Christians carnal? Why are so many Christians, so many who name the name of Christ, living like the world lives? Right here. Because though at some point we place faith in Christ, we hadn't been walking with Him. Oh, we pray before mealtime, maybe a short prayer before we close our eyes at night. Where is the real fellowship with Jesus Christ, with the God of heaven through Christ? I mean, where is that passion and longing that Paul had that says, I want to tell you that I may know Him. That's why I live. That's why I breathe. That I may know Him. Folks, this is why we don't have it. It's because we're not really the friend of God as Abraham was. And we're not really walking daily with God like Enoch was. And we're not truly people after God's own heart like David was. That's why we're struggling. That's why we're defeated. It is because of this right here. Listen, we don't have peace multiplied in our hearts. And grace multiplied in our hearts. And the power of God upon our hearts. And we're not laying hold of these exceeding great promises. And we're not walking in fellowship with the Spirit of God in us. Why? Because we are not drawing nigh to Him. We're satisfied and we're complacent. We're just happy to be saved and that's about it. Folks, I'm telling you something this morning will change your life and change my life. And Peter's talking about this is the way you know that you know that you know. You want to see authentic Christianity? Here it is. It's not a lukewarm Christian just satisfied and glad he's saved and traipsing along through life. It's one whose burning, yearning, passion and desire is to know God and Christ in a greater way than ever before. Faith that knows. Faith that knows. Tonight we're going to see faith that grows and faith that shows. But I want to challenge you this morning. Folks, I want to challenge you as I challenge my own heart. I want to challenge you to rededicate, recommit your life to Christ this morning. I want to challenge you to commit yourself to knowing Him afresh and anew. I want to challenge you to commit yourself to drawing nigh to Him, walking with Him daily and intimately as you have never done before. It'll change your life. Draw nigh to God, James said, and He will draw nigh to you. That's a promise. He will draw nigh to you. You want the grace of God in your life as never before? I do. You want the peace of God. The peace of God multiplied in your heart as never before. You want the power of God upon your life as never before. You want to lay hold of the promises of God as never before. All of these things be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Draw close to Him. Let's pray. How we love you, Lord. How I need this. And oh God, I pray you'd speak to our hearts. Have your way in our hearts. Might we be humble before thee and tender before thee. Regardless of where we're at in our walk, there is not a soul in here this morning who could not have a greater desire and passion to know you more. And so I pray that each of our hearts would be tender and receptive and responsive to your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take our hymnals to 311. 311, more about Jesus. The altar's open anyway. The Lord has spoken to your heart. You respond to Him. Let's stand together. 311. Joseph, it's good to have you home, brother.
Amen.
Would you close us in prayer this morning?
Dear Lord, I thank you so much for the day in your house.